Alright. We have three of us here. I think we can get going. Call this meeting of the Water Commission for Thursday, December 15th to order. Looks like it's 9:01-ish. Alright. Roll call. Looks like Commissioners Kilbourne, Davis, and Bernie are present. Commissioner Keller has got some health issues and won't be making it today, so we hope for a speedy recovery for him, and hopefully we'll see him back here in January. And Commissioner Jordan is not present at the moment. Okay, item number three, are there any changes to the agenda?
Mr. Chair, no, there's no changes.
All right. Moving on to number four, public comment. Is any... anybody from the public have any comments this morning? No? Okay. We'll move on to item number five, consent items. It's basically just the meeting minutes from October and November.
I need to recuse myself from the October since I was not here.
Okay. All right. I had a couple of minor comments about the consent items, the commissioners that made the motion. I am listed on a couple of them that we kind of just discussed, and I don't believe I made the motion, so we'll need to get those changed. But I think, barring any other changes...
Mr. Chair, I'd make a motion to approve the minutes with the changes in those two motions.
Perfect. Second?
I'll second.
All right. We have Davis, Bernie. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Nobody opposed. Okay. Perfect. Okay, moving on to item number 6A, the Water and Wastewater Capital Improvement Plan. Mr. Royero and Mr. Ward will be giving a presentation today. All yours.
Good morning, Commissioners and Chair. Thanks for the opportunity to speak this morning. And I'm going to start off with the water system FY or fiscal year 2018-2019 capital presentation. These are the items I'm going to be going over and our capital programs. We have the Cater Water Treatment Plant, the city's water distribution system, which is made up of its water mains, pump stations, reservoirs, our groundwater supply, recycled water, and water meters. During this planning period, we've, of course, been very preoccupied with drought and really having to focus our attentions there. We have continued to push forward a lean budget that addresses our immediate needs. And starting with some of those immediate needs is the Cater Water Treatment Plant equipment rehabilitation. In fiscal year 18, we're proposing $1 million in work that is comprised of baseline upgrades. Those are mainly small capital replacements, so large ticket component replacement projects that we get done from year to year, and then also comprised of some SCADA upgrades so we can maintain our communication systems. And we have a valve, we're in the second year of the valve actuator replacement project and looking to complete that project. Going to spend about $600,000 on that project so that way we can wrap up some of the major rehabilitation work that's been going on at the Cater Treatment Plant for some time. We are also proposing to replace the drives for the South Coast Conduit Pump Station. The drives ensure water to not only the city, but also our member agencies, so they will be contributing to the cost of that work. And we were really surgical, we felt like, in our approach here. We felt that some of the other components of the pump station had good remaining useful life, and that was kind of an approach we took to some of our pump station upgrades elsewhere that we'll touch more on. In fiscal year 2019, we're proposing a little less than $500,000 in, again, baseline upgrades, SCADA upgrades, and then also finishing up that work on the South Coast Conduit pump station drives. Annual Water Main Replacement Program. This is a really important program to us. As you know, we've received a lot of attention for the need to replace our mains. We're proposing that in both fiscal years, we move forward with continued funding for those programs or for that program. And again, the current objective is to replace 1% of the city's distribution system, which is made up of 300 miles of water mains. So we're planning to fund those projects and work away at them as we can. We've also been giving this area a lot of focus recently in asset management. And so we're looking forward to wrapping up some of our phase two work, which will bring back some results that will suggest that we are going to have to give this effort continued funding throughout the years and perhaps some serious increases. So,
Mr. Chair, do you want any questions as we go, or do you want to make the presentation questions at the end?
Questions as we go is fine.
Okay. I'm just curious. I'm fairly new in the Water Commission. How do you set the priorities on where you do your targeting replacements?
Great question. In the past, we've mainly tried to keep up with the areas where we're finding the highest number of water main breaks. We're moving away from that planning model, and we're moving towards a prioritized main replacement, which focuses on the risk that the water mains could present to the city, also the benefit. And then we're focusing on a long-term plan for how we can meet the replacement needs over a longer period of time and seeing how we can smooth those costs and address the needs.
And just curious, if you have a year where, in fact, you have a lot of main breaks in areas that weren't prioritized, how do you deal with that? Do you deal with the breaks as a separate type item and then still do the 1%? Or do you basically make shifting priorities during the year?
Almost all those costs are absorbed into the operations group. There is some small capital monies that for incidentals we do have to apply, but for the most part we try to keep our main replacement funds focused on main replacement. However, for the latest planning period we've had quite a bit of challenges due to drought, but usually we try to absorb those through operations.
Great, good, thanks.
Mr. Chair, Commissioners, I'd say our approach right now is run to failure. That's our approach with the water mains. There isn't adequate funding currently to keep up with the number of breaks that we have. It's been our goal to get back to the commission. We've been working over the last year, Matt and his staff, on an in-depth analysis of all of our water main assets and trying to bring back a plan. And we're really close at this point. I'm hoping in the next month or two we'll be able to come back and speak with you about that in great depth to kind of go into the challenges that we face, just trying to keep up with the current breaks that we have, but also trying to get ahead of those. And we're not alone. This certainly the rest of the country is kind of going through this. But I think I'm hoping that discussion will help kind of frame where we need to go. At this point, we're kind of setting kind of a status quo, but I think once we review the data, we'll want to revisit this and see how this fits in with all of our other drought expenditures that we have right now, but trying to get back on a track where I think we can get ahead of some of these main breaks.
Yeah. Thanks, Joshua. Going to move on now to our next topic, which is the pump station rehabilitation program. The city maintains 12 pump stations, and for FY18 we are planning to spend about $1.8 million. That mainly includes the El Salido pump station rehabilitation construction. Last year we did design. We are proposing that we move forward with construction. That pump station was originally installed in 1982. Many of the electrical components are now obsolete. As you can see in the picture there, we've been doing regular maintenance, but also repairs to the station, and we don't propose that we postpone that any further. So we're going to go ahead and move forward with construction, or plan to. And we are also working, again, like we were with the South Coast Booster Station, to replace the drives at the Cater Crosstie Pump Station, which serves a significant part of the upper elevations of our distribution system and provides support to fire activities up there as well. Both those pump stations were critical during the Hayseseda and the T fires. So we are confident in our proposal here. And then in FY19, we were planning to spend just under $1 million to begin to do design on two other pump stations that are critical also to our water system, Tunnel Pump Station, which serves the Mission Canyon area, and is in need of a full rehabilitation design, as well as Sheffield Pump Station, which is actually going to have, I think, a more limited project. We're looking to replace mainly the drives there. So again, being surgical in our approach to how we address the needs of our pump stations.
Mr. Chair, Commissioners, you know, El Salido is one of those projects we've been talking about for several years. We've at least been pushing off construction for the last 2 years. And we just feel at this time we can't afford to push it off any longer. You know, certainly we're hoping for the drought to end and it'd be more financially palatable to take on that. It's roughly about a $1.3 million project, but that's probably the biggest, most significant deviation, I guess, in this year's budget from what we were, I guess, originally planning to do. We just keep pushing it off, but something we don't think we can do anymore.
Thanks. And we're going to move on to our reservoir maintenance program. And it maintains the city's 13 reservoirs as well as Gibraltar Reservoir. For fiscal year 18, we are looking at baseline upgrades again, and then as also doing improvements to the Gibraltar intake structure, which is in need of some work to the intake valves, which allow us to flow water to the city. It's been, I think 1992 is the last time we did any work on that intake structure, and we've again pushed this project out about as far as we can, and we need to go ahead and move forward with that work. And that's looking at about $350,000 for that Gibraltar intake structure. In FY19, we're proposing $550,000, again, just to cover our baselines. That's just the bare minimum of what it takes to run these large cost, large value assets. We are also, we've given a lot of focus to this area as it's highly important to the city. And in future years, we're going to plan to come back and revisit our planning for how we're going to deal with these large assets over a period of time. We know we need to go into master planning. We know we have some serious capital needs in this area, and we're hoping to deal with those in the next 5 years, I would say.
We have a question?
Yes, I do. Thank you. Can you give an iconic example of a baseline upgrade? Sort of both in cost and just some particular that would give us an idea of what that investment looks like.
Thanks for asking that question. I would like to expound on that a bit. So the distribution system has hundreds of components that are from control valves, pressure valves, just critical components that we replace as needed, essentially. And those can range in cost anywhere from $10,000 to $50,000 for just a single component. So we work those into our capital planning as we can. And they're just items that typically are outside of an operations budget, so therefore they go to capital.
So for example, there's a reservoir control valve at Vic Trace.
Yeah.
And that valve is estimated about $50,000 to replace just that single valve. So those are just kind of the miscellaneous baseline stuff that the capital projects, because it's certainly not a simple maintenance project.
And that item is something that we've attempted to repair before. And now that we're going into desal operations and we're planning to use that reservoir even more, we've had to push forward with these types of upgrades.
What you'll also be seeing I'm hoping in 2019 is we'll start to work on a water system master plan. It's been a long time since we've really done any master planning, just going back and looking through the work that we've done. And certainly over the years, the way we operate the system has changed dramatically. The system was originally built around fire protection, big pipes, big reservoirs, you know, big everything. And now we are in a world where we're really focused on water quality. And the key to having good water quality is having good turnover, meaning the age of your water in your system is low, which means you want that water, once it gets treated, enters the system and is used frequently. And so trying to balance those needs with recognized fire needs is important. But I think we need to come back and look at our system. I think we have some reservoirs, certainly have reservoirs that are over 100 years old in our system. and are coming up on some planned maintenance needs. Do we need a reservoir of that size still in that location? Can we get away with something smaller if we replace it? To all the questions that we're hoping to look at, again, trying to also improve potentially the circulation in the water system in general, trying to get rid of any of those areas, and we call dead ends, where there's not as much demand in the system, and so the water gets older in those areas. So those are all kind of the focus of what we'd like to kick off as part of the master plan, and it's been something that's we've been discussing internally, but because of the drought, we keep kind of pushing it out. But I think at some point here, we're just going to have to bite the bullet and get that going, because that effort is going to speak to how much and what we do with some of our pump station and reservoir upgrades in the future.
And I think we're going to be right for some of that planning too, because with the current challenges of drought, we're running the distribution system at an all-time low. So we've really seen what the distribution systems had to do and had to perform through a variety of conditions, and we feel confident that the planning work we're going to do now, we're doing now during drought, that we're going to be able to apply that to this master planning effort hopefully in the next few years. So moving on to our next item, groundwater supply program. We've really just put $100,000 into each fiscal year, so that way we have some funds available to keep pumping the basin. So these are just the minimal funds that it takes in order to replace pumps, motors, and deal with if there's consultation we need for emerging challenges with pumping the distribution system at the level that it's at, or I'm sorry, not the distribution system, the groundwater system. So we'll we're planning to have some funds available to deal with the, keeping the system up and going.
Mr. Chair, lots of little questions. Sorry about this. Assuming we somehow in a couple of years came out of the drought, right, and you start to rest the basins. On these particular, do you take the wells down for full maintenance during those periods?
We have, and we plan to.
Yeah.
Currently our plan is to pump at our maximum capacity.
Right. So, after the 2 years, but yeah.
Yeah, but certainly we plan to ease our pumping and rest the basin, and then we've got some plans that we're evaluating for recharging the basin, and we will be working in a planned maintenance as soon as we get a chance.
Good. Okay. Thanks.
Based on current pumping, we estimate that once the drought ends, we'll likely shut down our groundwater for 5 to 10 years to let the groundwater basin recover. So it'd be pretty substantial, and so we'll be looking at that. We've also kicked off an effort to take a look at ASR, which is our ability to inject water back into the groundwater basin, maybe to speed its recovery. We're currently working on permitting to make that a reality, but there's also a lot of challenges with that kind of operation as well.
All right, our recycled water program. As you know, we have a recycled distribution system, and it was originally installed about 25 years ago. And we are proposing about $350,000 in fiscal year 18 to deal with the needs of that distribution system. A lot of the electrical components, the SCADA components, the controls, the communications are in desperate need of upgrading. Obviously, with the changing technologies and the future of recycled water is a little bit uncertain how it's going to fit into our supply planning. So we're just proposing just the minimal upgrades to keep the pump station up and operational with the goal of having it last another 5 to 10 years. And fiscal year 19, we have just absolute minimal funds to run that distribution system. We've done a lot of great work in the past few years operationally to make sure that the distribution system can handle the changes within the wastewater treatment plans. So we feel like we've optimized the system. This is some of the $350,000 that's proposed in here will go towards finishing our optimization, so that way we have maximum flexibility within that system to meet all the needs, and we've worked closely with our users to really dial that system in and spend as little as possible to make sure we can meet all the demands.
We might talk about this later, but as I understand it, the recycled water facility still isn't operating at the capacity that we expected it to when we did the remodel last year. So are there funds in that 350? Is that what you're talking about with the optimization, or what? Where are we?
I want to make sure that I'm specific. Yeah, I'm talking to the recycled water distribution system. And then primarily, I'll let Joshua speak to.
Mr. Chair, Commissioners, we'll be back in January to talk in more detail on this, but we do have a plan right now to get the facility back up to its design capacity, and are working right now to kind of put that scope down and get a contractor lined up to basically kick off that work and get it done before this next summer. I think where we stand right now is we feel confident we can produce about 1.5 million gallons a day, and our goal is to get up to 2.5. And so we've identified the improvements that we believe are necessary to get there. And so that next step is to bring that back in January. I'm hopeful we'll have a contract in January that we can sit down and discuss more and the game plan to get that there.
And part of the optimization was to plan to make sure that we can distribute that water and be flexible how we distribute that water. So thanks. Our water meter replacement program. So a couple of years ago, we came to you and let you know that we wanted to replace our small water meters. We set a goal of replacing those 23,000 water meters over a 5-year period. And I'm happy to report that we are continuing to meet that goal despite the drought, despite the water quality issues we've had to work through. We chose to do this program using operations staff because we felt that it was a great opportunity for us to engage our users. You don't get the opportunity all the time to meet your users, you know, at their front door and actually discuss with them what you're doing for them and replacing their water meters. And we wanted to take the opportunity to continue to uphold the high level of trust that we want to have with our customer base in high regards. So like I said, I'm happy to report that we are moving along. We've currently replaced 12,500 meters, and in the next 2 years we will plan to maintain that program and hope to report to you at the end of that we will have our small water meters replaced.
Another question, sorry. If I remember correctly, we talked about advanced metering infrastructure, so meters that could actually be read remotely. Is that what is going in? Are they AMI capable? Can you?
Yes, yeah. So we were very considerate of that when we started this project. And, you know, of course, then there was more talk of going to AMI. That infrastructure is still being considered, you know, in the future. Hopefully not so distant future, as it's got a lot of potential. But the meters that we do have now that are going in the ground are capable of connecting to an AMI system.
Are those going to require any kind of retrofit once we transition to that system? Or
well, we chose to use a NiCore connector, which is basically like the USB connector for a water meter. So hopefully it's a plug-and-play system. You connect a radio to it, and then you have transmitters, which then route that information to a hub, and then it can be used to communicate with our users and then also learn more about our distribution system. Very powerful technology that could really advance our work. So looking forward to bringing back recommendations on that as we move past drought.
Okay, good.
So in summary, this is what the budget looks like. You'll notice that the bottom line is that we're fluctuating between a little over $8 and $9 million in planning. Like Joshua pointed out, with the El Cielito pump station construction, we have a little bit of an increase in 18, and then you'll see a slight decrease in 19. And we really consider this the baseline capital funding that we need to continue to deal with our distribution system and our treatment system. And we're hopeful that in future years, we'll be able to increase spending to meet the needs that we know we have coming. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Lisa.
Thank you, and good morning. My name is Lisa Arroyo. I am the Wastewater System Manager, and I'm pleased today to be presenting the Wastewater System Capital Improvement Program for fiscal years 2018 and 2019. I'll start with the Collection System Annual Program. We are planning on both fiscal years 18 and 19 to budget about $1.75 million. The major elements of this annual program is to repair, rehabilitate, and or replace our collection system piping. We have a system of about 257 miles of gravity main, and as you'll see on the next slide I'll show, we average somewhere between 4 and 6 miles per year of generally rehab and repair on those lines. Another component is our CCTV work. We contract out a lot of our CCTV inspection work. In fiscal year 18 specifically, we will be replacing our own CCTV equipment on our van. That'll be about $250,000. And we'll also be doing our CCTV inspection of our large diameter pipes. We do that about every 5 years, and we're going to be planning on doing that in fiscal year 18. Fiscal year 19, we'll be looking to do some improvements and repairs on the El Camino sewer trestle. That is a sewer trestle that connects the cul-de-sac at El Camino de la Luz and La Mesa Park. We'll be painting it, doing some concrete repairs, in addition to our standard 1 to 2% of our system per year. The other thing we do with this annual program is we do our contract on asset management, and that is usually about $100,000 to $150,000 per year. This slide shows the sewer mains that we've repaired over the past 4 years. We range again from somewhere between 4 and 6 miles. On average, we're at about 5. It kind of depends on some of the other elements that we bring in when we are going to be doing our large diameter CCTV project next year. I would expect to see a more on the 4 to 5 range, mile range. When we don't do some of that more expensive work, we can flex up to about six miles. I think one of the things that's been helpful for us to go above the 1% and to be able to stay above that 1% is the use of trenchless technology. We do a lot of spot lining, we do a lot of rehabilitation, and that's really been able to help us cover more ground with our mains versus the traditional dig and replace. And it's also much more convenient for the public and quicker. We have a annual lift station program. We have 7 lift stations in the city. Back in 2012, Brown and Caldwell did a lift station condition assessment report for us. It helped us identify where we needed to be spending our money and the criticality of all of the improvements that need to be made. In the last couple of years, we focused on putting in redundant force mains. We did that at our La Colina lift station. We just finished up at, or finishing up right now at our Braemar lift station. We're just now finishing up with some valve work. Moving forward to the next couple of years, we're going to be doing a full rehab on the Braemar lift station. I expect that to take 2 years, where we will be funding design this fiscal year. We just got back proposals, and we'll be evaluating those and hiring a consultant to do design this year. We'll be looking at spending at about $50,000 for any permitting as part of this project, and then we'll be going into construction in fiscal year 19. I expect the total project cost to come in around $2.5 million. We'll be replacing the pumps. We'll be putting in variable frequency drives. We'll be looking at electrical improvements. I think we'll be replacing our generator. Quite honestly, I think we've figured out that they built part of the Braemar lift station around the generator because we can't figure out how they got it in there some 20 years ago. Lining our wet well, full rehab on this. It is our most critical lift station because it's the volume of wastewater that comes through and that proximity to Arroyo Borough Creek. We want to get it completely dialed in for the future. In future years, we'll be looking at continuing to implement the work from the Brown and Caldwell study, and we're working on lining that up as we go.
Mr. Chair, just a quick question in terms of the Braemar, the area that it serves. It serves just the Braemar, and does it also serve Campanile Hill?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's essentially their service area then? Doesn't Hope Ranch obviously is probably all on septic, right?
You know, it's not part of our service. I don't know if they're on septic, but I would guess.
Because there's no service area. But yeah. So essentially, it's Braemar and Campanile. Mm-hmm. Basically feeds this particular pump station. Okay, thanks.
Yeah. And San Roque, I think, as well.
Probably not.
Wow.
It's got a lot of, I think it's 500,000 gallons per day capacity pumping. So it's one of our biggest ones. So the next program is our El Estero Strategic Plan. This has traditionally been used as a planning and design for the betterment of the El Estero equipment and processes. We've done a lot of planning studies. We've done a lot of asset management. Fiscal year 17, just a few months ago, we funded the facility plan that Brown and Caldwell is going to be doing. They're taking a 10-year look at our equipment, assessing it, ranking it by criticality, and putting together projects to meet our budget. And moving forward in fiscal year 18 and 19, I feel like we can really scale back the budget because we've accomplished so much. We just upgraded our CMMS system. That is our computerized maintenance management system at the plant. And I feel it's time to take the training wheels off and divert the money that we have been traditionally spending, which is about $500,000, into capital improvements. So that's what this program is looking like, at least in the next 2 years. There's also the El Estero Maintenance Program. That's where we are upgrading our pumps, our pipes, not the big, large capital projects, but where we look at the whole process area, but the smaller ones. And in fiscal year 17, we have already funded the design for the what we're calling the solids handling project. That's going to be a precursor to the larger biosolids project, where we're going to be putting in primary sludge pumps that will enable us to pump sludge down to the digesters, which will be really important when we do the biosolids project. We'll be putting in an interim vector dump station. We'll be doing some manhole rehabilitation work on our critical manholes that are in not such good shape. And just a couple other items that will help us in the future. Again, design is funded. We're going to be looking to construct this next fiscal year in 18. It's funded at about $2.2 million is what I expect it to be. And then starting in fiscal year 19, we'll be starting to pluck off of that list that Brown and Caldwell is preparing for us as part of the master plan, and we'll start implementing that work. Some of the other projects that we have going on that I just want to mention are the Secondary Process Improvements Project. That's that SRF-funded $33 million project. It is currently in construction. That's a shot right there of Aeration Basin 6, where they should be completing the work on that aeration basin in about January, February timeline. And they'll keep rolling through all of the basins until they are complete with all of the work. We plan on coming back to the commission at the one-year mark with an update on the project and to kind of show you some cool pictures and what's been accomplished and how much longer we expect it to take. But we went into it expecting a two-year project. We started it late spring, so it's about springtime that we'll be coming back to you. The El Estero Drain Restoration Project, that's that parcel in between the plant and the railroad tracks. I'm pleased that we have a substantial conformance determination from community development that happened last month. We'll be looking to move forward with construction of that project, likely summer, fall time, where it's a lot of restoration that we'll be doing. So we're going to try to time the plants around coming up wet weather so we can hopefully capitalize on a rain event and helping establish the plants. That's already funded at about $350,000. And then we have the biosolids project that's up and coming. We are working towards kind of finessing the conceptual design. We'll be applying for a loan, and with with once we receive the loan, we'll be doing preliminary design.
That's true. Just going back on the El Estero Drain project, could you tell me just generally the geographic length of that project? And you're talking about the central drainage channel, the creek.
Correct. It's parallel to the railroad tracks. It's Laguna Channel up to kind of where our digesters are, and then there's a fence there, and, you know, then it turns into Fess Parker property.
Right. Yeah.
I don't know how long it is.
No, but that was the description. I'm just really from here to here, so you gave me an idea. But it's parallel to the railroad tracks.
Correct. It's a parcel of land just from the back of our plant to the rail tracks.
Were they turtles or?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. What was the trigger for this project again?
It's got a very long history.
Dave Johnson bought the property back when for expansion of the plant. It turned out that it was an environmentally sensitive habitat, and other projects that they've done in the area, it was required by planning to basically restore that particular area as part of a coastal development permit. That's the short story.
Okay.
Correct. When we started working on it, we hit hot soils, and then we had to do remediation, and it's got a very long history, and we are finally at the point where there's consensus and we are able to move forward and get the work done.
That's a pricey purchase.
Yeah.
So similar to Matt's slide, here's just a basic budget summary for 18-19. Again, we'll be doing about $1.75 million in collection system work, mainly rehab and repair. We'll be doing design this year with construction in 19 on the Braemar lift station. We will be scaling back our strategic plan from what it's been in the past to about 50,000 per year. We will be doing a large maintenance project at the plant at about $2.2 million, and that's the line item that we would expect to start funding some of the other capital work that is a result of the master plan. And then the biosolids project, that's going to be SRF funded. We're hopeful that we can start the preliminary design next year in 18 with final design in 19. And that concludes our presentation. So if you have any additional questions, we'd be happy to answer them.
I just had a question about the overall improvements cost. How does the next couple of years compare to what we've done the last, like this year and last year, like
cost-wise? For wastewater, water,
yeah.
That's challenging to answer because we have some very large capital projects that were debt-funded. And so if you take that portion out and you just look at our pay-as-you-go, we're pretty consistent. We are, you know, with rate increases, we are increasing a little bit each year, but that's appropriate. We do need to fund additional capital as our systems, our equipment all starts to reach its lifespan.
Okay, thanks. Any other questions? All right, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Okay, we will move on to item number 6B. The CCRB response to the state water rights order. We have Mr. Del Francisco here to give us a presentation.
Thank you.
Good morning, Chairman Kielborn, Commissioners, Councilmember White. I'm Dale Francisco, Interim General Manager of the Kachuma Conservation Release Board, or CCRB. CCRB was founded as a joint powers authority in 1973 to protect the Kachuma water rights of all of the South Coast water agencies. What I'm going to be talking about today is a new draft water rights permit from the State Water Resources Control Board. And the discussion is going to be broken down into three parts. The first part will be some history of the State Board itself and how we got to this point with this draft order. Then I'll be talking about, I'll focus on the water supply impacts of the new draft order. And finally, I'll discuss CCRB's comments that we recently returned to the State Board. So the regulation of surface water in California has a long and colored history. Before 1914, any disputes regarding water rights between appropriators and riparians were resolved in the courts, most of the time occasionally with dynamite, but mostly in the courts. And in 1914, the state legislature decided that that was too haphazard, and they established the State Water Commission. The rights and powers of these various organizations over time have changed, but water rights has always been central to each of the new bodies. In 1956, the Water Commission was replaced by the Water Rights Board, and in 1967, the current body, the State Water Resources Control Board, and I will refer to that in the rest of this presentation as the State Board. Here is a brief history, a very brief history, of the water rights permits pertaining to Kachuma. And understand that these water rights permits, though they affect us, what they are really about is negotiations between the United States Bureau of Reclamation, the organization that built the dam, and the State Water Resources Control Board, the State Board. So in 1958, the State Board issued the original Kachuma permits, which the Bureau had applied for in 1946, before construction had even begun. In 1983, the Bureau petitioned for what's called a change in place of use. And what that means in Bureau terminology is the people that it's serving, the various water agencies, the boundaries of the area that they were serving had changed, had grown. And they are required, when that happens, to apply for a change in place of use. In 1987, the California Sports Fishing Alliance lodged a complaint with the State Board against the Bureau of Reclamation, saying that Kachuma had ruined their sport fishing opportunities for steelhead on the San Ynez River. So in 2000, the State Board began a hearing on all of these issues, including downstream water rights, which of course has been one of the most contentious issues on the San Ynez River for a century. And the just as an aside, those downstream water rights issues were largely resolved in 2002 by a settlement agreement among all of the parties concerned, all the local parties concerned. So our attorney informed me that this draft order has been one of the longest coming in the history of the State Board. Those hearings began on 2000, and we received their draft water rights order on September 7th, 2016, 16 years. Comments on that were due on December 19th, and we submitted those. There are lots of things in this draft order, but I will focus today on what we consider to be the major change, which was a change in the fish flow regime from two alternatives that were in the final EIR. Final EIR was released in 2011. Alternative 3C to alternative 5C. Alternative 3C in the EIR was based on the 2000 biological opinion that we had received, or the Bureau had received, from National Marine Fisheries. 5C is a version of a proposal from Caltrout that was modified by the State Board. And essentially what they did is Caltrout had said, this is the flow regime that we think should exist all the time. The State Board modified that, dialed it back a little bit, and said, we're okay with that, but only in those water years that we classify as either above normal or wet. Okay, let's talk about alternative 3C. There are lots of things in alternative 3C, but if we look just at the water section of it, it was predicated on there being a surcharge of Kachuma of 3 feet, which the Bureau did by adding height to the spillway gates. And that added 3 feet of surcharge to the reservoir, added roughly 9,200 acre feet to the reservoir capacity. And that 9,200 acre feet, the new acre feet, were allocated to three fish accounts, one for rearing, one for passage, and one for adaptive management. 3C specifies rearing flows with top priority given to Hilton Creek. It specifies passage flows for emigration either downstream or upstream. And it does a whole bunch of other things, storm operations, certain restrictions on state water project releases, the non-flow fish conservation elements such as the tributary enhancements. But we're going to focus here on the flows. So here's an example of some of the things that 3C dictated. So for instance, 10 CFS at Highway 154, you're probably all familiar with this, but I'll step back and explain just for a moment. So the river from the dam to Solvang is divided into three reaches. The first reach goes from the dam to where 154 goes over the river. The second reach goes from that point to Sunstone Vineyard, where Refugio Road crosses the river. And then the final reach is from there to where the river crosses Al Sol Road. So anyway, this specifies that in that first reach, there would be a flow rate of 10 CFS whenever the reservoir spills and the spill amount exceeds 20,000 acre feet. The second item there, 5 CFS at Highway 154, if the reservoir doesn't spill or the spill amount is less than 20,000 acre feet and storage exceeds 120,000 acre feet. And I'm not going to go into the rest of the details here, but I just wanted to give you a flavor of the kind of thing that is specified in the biological opinion. So how does that differ from 5C? 5C had the same flow regime as 3C in below normal, dry, or critical water years. Caltrout proposed these so-called Table 2 flows, and those are implemented in 5C in above normal and wet years. And like 3C, it has all of these other provisions, which I'm not going to go into here. So here's an example of the Table 2 flows. These are the flows that would happen in years that are either above normal or wet years. And as you can see, just glancing there at the left-hand side, the flows we're talking about here are considerably larger than they are in 3C. And I'll talk a little bit about the implications of that shortly. So for instance, 48 CFS from mid-February to mid-April for spawning, and then all the other purposes that you see there. One of the things to note about this is all of these plans essentially turn at least that reach of the San Ynez River from the dam to Solvang into a perennial river. And that is not historically what the San Ynez River has been. There have always been dry periods when the river went dry. So what are the water supply impacts of this change from 3C to 5C? In most years, the immediate impact in any one year in a wet or above normal year is not really going to be noticeable. Our concern is with the dry years. The EIR suggests that we would have on average a 1,500 acre foot per year shortfall in dry periods because of the cumulative effect of having released more water as compared to 3C. We think that that's probably a minimum estimate, and we're doing hydrologic modeling work to get a better idea of what the actual number is. A lot of things have changed since 2000, and we really need to do more work to understand the real impacts, but we're concerned that the real water supply impact could could be anywhere from 2 to 4 times as great as what the EIR says. So CCRB turned in a comment letter on December 9th, and in that comment letter, we raised 9 issues with what the state board order tells us to do. And I've divided those into procedural issues, biological, CEQA issues, water impact issues, and practical issues, for want of a better term. The procedural issues are, first, one of the things that the state board does, and it's something that they've started doing recently but didn't used to do, is they delegate authority to the state board's executive director to modify flows without a hearing. So it's sort of an adaptive management program, if you like, but they've given the authority to do that unilaterally to the executive director. And we believe that there's no justification for that, that it's if nothing else, a due process violation. The second thing that they've done in the draft order, and this is, they recognize that 5C is going to have a water supply impact. And one of the ways they try to mitigate that is they're telling the Bureau to include conservation measures, to force conservation measures on the stakeholders, so the City of Santa Barbara and everyone else who's using water from Kachuma. And we believe that there is absolutely no legal basis for the state board to tell a federal agency what kind of contract it negotiates with its contractors. Biological issues, and this is really at the crux of this. We did not know when we began to implement the biological opinion back in 2000 what was going to happen. The theory was that putting more water into the main stem of the river was going to create more environment, more habitable environment for steelhead, and obviously whatever passage benefits in the passage flows would accrue. What we have found in the real world is that we have created an ideal environment for bass. And the problem with that, of course, bass are an invasive species. They are absolutely fatal to young steelhead. There do not appear to be any spawning steelhead in the main stem of the river below the dam. And I'll give you an example. We just recently, because of the drought and because the water level is dropping even in that area immediately below the dam, we had 2 rescue, quote unquote, operations. There's a stilling basin immediately below the dam. And that's one area where there are fish. Then there's a pretty short stretch of river, like maybe a third of a mile, and then an area that's called the Long Pool, which, as the name implies, is a long pool. And we seined both of those areas, comb seined both of those areas, and found hundreds of bass and sunfish and not a single rainbow or steelhead trout. So that is the unpleasant for steelhead environment that we've ended up creating below the dam with this perennial flow regime. So we think that given that 3C has created this disaster, 5C can only be worse. And there's no evidence in the record to prove otherwise. So that this is what I think is really one of the most important things to take away from this. Our experience over the last 16 years of the biological opinion has been we've actually made things worse for steelhead in the river. The other thing I should mention here, we never used to have beaver in the San Ynez River. It was only once we established this perennial flow regime that beaver showed up, started building dams, and that also is bad for the steelhead, both in terms of migration obstacles, and again, the pools that are established behind beaver dams turn out to be great for bass. CEQA issues. I won't spend too much time on this. There's whenever you do something that has a class one impact according to CEQA, you have to have a statement of overriding considerations that proves why it's worthwhile doing this in spite of the damage it's going to do. The class one unmitigated impact here is the impact on our own water supplies. And we believe that given that there's no evidence in the record that 5C is going to make things better, and we have empirical evidence that it'll probably make things worse, that their overriding consideration statement is inadequate. This is another complicated one. We believe that the draft order fails to really adequately describe what the water supply impacts will be. We're not even entirely sure what the water supply impacts on us will be, but I can give you an example of the sort of things that are going to be a problem. Kachuma is a very, very complicated operational system, and it's operating under state water rights permits. There's, you know, I've only talked about this one and one preceding one. There are approximately, off the top of my head, I don't know, 12 water right permits that Kachuma is operating under. And it's operating under a biological opinion. And it's operating under the settlement agreement I spoke of in 2002 with the downstream water rights users. All of these things interact in complicated ways, and they interact in complicated ways with the actual mechanism of Kachuma itself. So I'll give you one example. In 3C, it was possible with those flows of no greater than 10 CFS fish flows, it was possible to route all of that water through Hilton Creek. Hilton Creek is a small tributary just to the south of the dam that runs almost immediately into the San Ynez River. So we could put all of the fish flows through Hilton Creek because it has the capacity. With this new flow regime in 5C, you saw one of those flow periods is at 48 CFS. We can't release 48 CFS through Hilton Creek. So some of it will have to go through the outlet works. The outlet works is also the place, mysteriously, where the State Water Project pipeline comes in, even though it says outlet works. That's where state water comes into the dam and gets pumped into the reservoir. According to the biological opinion, we cannot mix state water with fish flow releases. So all of a sudden, we're going to have a considerable period of the year where we can't pump state water into Kachuma because it would violate the biological opinion's restriction on not mixing state water with fish flow releases. So that's just, I mean, that is one tiny example of the kind of complications that are involved here and that the state board couldn't possibly have predicted when they just looked at their simple map. And said, oh, yeah, 48 CFS, no problem. Big problem.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Another addition to that is the past, just because it's so germane to our activities. If you haven't mentioned, are you going to mention the pass-through agreement, or is this an okay moment to mention
that? That's a fine moment to do that. I wasn't planning to.
Yeah, well, just as in addition to that, the city has, through litigation and negotiation, developed a pass-through agreement which allows Gibraltar water to be stored in Kachuma and so forth and so on. It's just one more, you know, add another set of complications and formulas and agreements and contracts and such as well. So the upstream and then Montecito, I expect that if not now, then someday that kind of activity would go on with Juncal as well.
So moving right along here, the practical issues that we have a problem with, for whatever reason, the state board decided to put in a demand that we install a gauge at the Highway 154 crossing. This is something that keeps coming up again and again. It seems fairly straightforward to me. We've explained to them it's private property, Nancy Crawford Hall's private property, and she's not willing to let us do it, so we'd have to go through eminent domain. And it's also a bad place to measure because it happens to be a place where the channel is frequently changing. It's not stable. And we've got other ways of measuring it that NMFS have approved. The other thing that is really alarming to me is the day before we were ready to submit these comments, we got the comments from NMFS on this same state order. And one of the things they're asking for is for the state board to delay finalizing the order until after the who knows when 2017 perhaps NMFS biological opinion is finalized. And given past experience, I would think that finalizing that biological opinion is going to be a minimum of a five-year process. And so to me, this is absolutely intolerable. one of the big problems that we've had with not having a final draft order from the state. We have a provision in the settlement agreement that says critical drought operations. It describes critical drought operations that will happen that will conserve water in the reservoir by cutting down all the other release schedules. One of the provisions of that in the settlement agreement is that it doesn't go into effect until we have a final state board order. So throughout this drought, we have not been able to implement the critical drought operations in the settlement agreement because we don't have a state board order. No one ever assumed that this would have gone on as long as it did when we made that agreement. So we submitted these comments, as I said, on December 9th. We will be probably in the middle of discussion with the state board, I would assume, for at least the next 6 months before we have a final order. Sometime during those 6 months, I expect we will get a new biological opinion from National Marine Fisheries. I also expect that whatever is in that biological opinion will be far more damaging and catastrophic to our water supply than what the state board has given us. But I think we've made a reasonable case that the existing 3C is the right approach for the moment until we have more knowledge. One of the things that we said in our letter is that the state board order says implement 5C and, oh, by the way, do all these studies to figure out if 5C is a good idea. And we think if we're going to do those studies, we should do the studies first before we implement 5C. Any questions?
Oh, first, thank you. I mean, that was a good explanation and overview of a letter which I read three times and still walked away kind of going, what did that say? One thing that I did pick up, I didn't want to ask you about, Mr. Francisco, was this 5C versus 3C. Someone said that somewhere in here it said the 3C was the environmentally superior alternative in the EIR.
That's true.
Okay. Given that, and they've chosen to basically look at 5C, what was their explanation on why they did not choose the environmentally superior alternative?
What
they state that on the record in your findings if you're not choosing that.
So what they said was the experience of the last 10 years is that 3C has not shown evidence of being on the way to restoring the steelhead below the dam in good condition. And what we say about that is that there is evidence that there are more steelhead in the river now than there were. We also point out the testimony of Chuck Hansen back during the hearings, who said that given that when the dam was built, Congress realized that this was probably going to be the end of the steelhead run in the San Ynez River. That was acknowledged. Given that reality, what Mr. Hansen said was it is probably going to take on the order of 80 to 100 years to reestablish a sustainable steelhead population below the dam. Finally, the other thing that's obviously had a major impact on fisheries all over California, not just San Ynez River, is the longest drought in history over the past 5 years. So we're arguing that their claim that the steelhead have not come back quickly enough is not valid.
That was the point that I was going to make.
Any other questions?
And that is there's at the same, of course, CCRB was not the only commenter on this draft water rights order. You have the various San Ynez stakeholders, Bureau of Reclamation, and then, of course, Caltrout. I don't think I've seen the Caltrout comments, but the one I wanted to comment on was comes out of the San Ynez River, where I think if you were to read this document, there's a sense of collaboration and saying we want some changes here, but we're working with you in that basic sense. Whereas I believe it's the ID1 letter is like, this is so bad. You know, it's like, this is a terrible thing. And, you know, and so there's a much more, I used the word pugnacious when I previously described it, style to the letter. And of course, the concern expectation is that they're just aching for a bona fide conflict out of this. So. But I really, first of all, just this letter is very much very constructive, and I hope has a strong chance of getting a favorable consideration. And by the way, this was very helpful for me to have seen this history and your explanation. Really, a useful presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Chair. That's really helpful, Benny. And I also thought that the letter did basically in tone, et cetera, try to be constructive in that regard. I know that NOAA Fisheries has been working on a steelhead restoration plan for the entire West Coast. Have they commented on this yet? Have you seen a comment from NOAA in that regard?
I have seen the comments from NIMFS. Yeah. And unfortunately, I scanned them rather quickly in the process of working on getting our comments out. And really, the main thing I noted was the demand to wait on issuing the final board order. But yeah. I can forward that to you if you're interested.
I'm only curious because they've been working for whatever 10 years on the restoration plan. I was curious how that restoration plan lined up with this new regime of water releases that we're talking here. And if they had any comment, you know, plus or minus in that regard, the discussion again. I'm just not conversant enough. The whole bass issue mm-hmm. is really fascinating. I mean, mm-hmm. again, that's something which I'm curious. And beavers, I didn't think were endemic to Southern California. Mm-hmm. So all that is pretty fascinating. I'd be curious to see the resolution between the technical people and in terms of NIMFS and us in that regard also. Yeah. But. And just one last comment. I don't think in 1950, whatever it was, they were really caring much about the steelhead. So, anyway, thank you again for the presentation.
All right. Any other questions? Appreciate it. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
That was excellent.
Thank you.
Information. Okay. Moving along to item number 6C. Well, go through the annual water supply report and the stage 3 drought update. Actually, I want to, we got a minute while you're pulling that up. Can we jump back? It's been bugging me since we did this, but on the consent items, since the October meeting minutes were the commissioners present were myself, Mr. Davis, and Mr. Keller. And Ms. Burney has to recuse herself from...
We would not have a quorum.
We would not have a quorum for that item, which sadly means we'll probably have to bring item 5A back to get approval on. Is that true?
Unfortunately, our legal couldn't attend today, but that would probably be a very conservative position. It would just be that we'd bring it back when we do have a quorum.
That's true. Either that or... If, in fact, it was an improper motion, we'd bring it back. But otherwise, it could stand once you check with legal staff.
Mm-hmm. I can check with them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. I didn't mean to make it more confusing, but started thinking about that.
All right. So, Mr. Chair, Commissioners, Joshua Hagmark, Water Resources Manager, and I have a truncated Stage 3 drought update so that we can get into our 2016 annual water supply management report. So let's start off with the drought status, and I know we're all excited today because it's a potential for a little over an inch of rain today, which would be fantastic. But you'll note where we stand currently, which for Gibraltar, 2.43 inches, which is roughly 50% of normal. So we roughly need another two and a half inches of rain to get to normal. And at this point, normal isn't going to cut it. We need to actually see some significant rainfall to make a difference here. And so as much as this inch of rain is going to be helpful, it isn't alone isn't going to change much related to our water supply plan. We need another inch every other week to really turn things around. Did it move? Yay. Perfect. Again, NOAA's predictions from January through March are still calling for below average rainfall for Southern California. What happened here? Okay. There's the graphic I want to look at. It appears when you, well, we'll just look at it in this light here. What I wanted to get across here with this, I apologize, it's not working, is what we have here is the three driest years on record, starting with the 47 to 52 period, in which we received 105 inches of rain. The 1988 through 91, 87 through 91, where we received 92 inches of rain. And then the 2011 through 2016, where we've received 63 inches of rain. So when we talk about how dry it's been, nearly 30 inches drier than the worst 5 years on record is what we're talking about here. And then you can imagine how this just compounds year after year. I mean, that's just a significant. And what's, I was looking back at this data, and all of these in the fifth year, you know, they had 50 inches of rain, they had 30 inches. That was the miracle month of March where they got 25 inches of rain. And then we didn't quite get that last year. But the point being here is that this does compound. This issue is significant. I mean, it's last year, as we talked about before, we got right up to that point where another couple of inches and we would have seen some, actually started to see some runoff, and that's when it just kind of stopped. And so to get to that point, hopefully this year, where we see some runoff would just be spectacular. But this is kind of the deficit that we're working with. This is just, when we talk about this being an historic drought of record, this is just how much drier it's been than anything we've had in the past, and, you know, particularly some of the droughts we've used for our planning purposes. Let's see, hope everything works here from now on. Okay. So conservation continues to still be a bright spot. We've got 34% conservation in November. As we've talked about, as we get into our winter months, it's really difficult to hit these high conservation numbers because there just isn't the outdoor discretionary water use. We have made some changes. I think we talked a little bit about this last time we met. We will be presenting the 12-month running average. And what we've done here kind of changed up a little bit. In these numbers that we've been reporting and the numbers that report to the state, we also include savings that we've had because we did not have to use potable water in our recycled water system. That's a combined number that we present to the state. We've taken out that component in this, and so this is purely what the community has done. That's what that 33% running average represents, and that's what we need to get up to 40%. And so as you kind of recognize with that, in order to get to 40%, there's going to be months this summer where we're going to be up in the high 40s, if not 50%, in order to get that average 40% conservation.
If I may add, since we declared the 35% conservation target, the community has been meeting that. It's just that the 12-month average includes a portion of the year when we had the 25% target. So that's why it's showing at a 33% on average over 12 months.
Real quick on Kachuma, it has it actually has been going up. And part of that is because of our state water deliveries. We've been making quite a bit of headway in that point. We were hoping to. That was the plan this time of year. Demand's falling off. We needed to be stockpiling water in the lake, and so that's ongoing. We do anticipate, and I'll be going over this a little bit in a graphic, that our remaining water in the lake, water originating from the San Ynez River, will be exhausted by the end of this month. And we were able to get the new evacuation formula to take effect, and so that'll start January 1st, and that will be tremendously beneficial to all the users in helping to have some realistic evaporation formulas going forward. So this is a little graphic we just put together that kind of shows here is the remaining water that's in the lake. The purple represents the minimum pool. It's supposed to be at 10,000. It's less than that because of the over-release from the ANA account. And so it basically is just under 8,600. The carryover is the light turquoise with 2,900. Sorry, this is the dark blue. The little wedge that says 754, that's our carryover. That's what we expect to be exhausted by the end of this year. And imported state water, and that's at 2,900 acre feet and right now growing, which is good. So I'm going to just talk about that remaining sliver there. Of that water that's left in there, the city has about 220 acre feet of that, which, like we said, we have mentioned, we expect to use that all this month. And then Goleta has about 500 acre feet of that water, which they are going to leave. This is on purpose because of their Goleta West conduit arrangement. They are planning to carry this water through, and we've all kind of agreed to this with the Bureau. But if they were not carrying that water through, it'd basically be gone too. It was on purpose. And Montecito and Carpinteria's water, those little tiny wedges, will be gone by the end of this month. So this is the remaining water that originated from the San Ynez River. And then we have here the state water that's being imported. The city has the chunk of that, the largest chunk, 1,570 acre feet, is the city's. And then you see Montecito's, Carpinteria's, and Goleta's make up the remaining balance. But this is the balance that we're hoping to continue to grow because it's key to meeting our demands this next summer. Gibraltar currently sits empty, and you may have seen in the news and just wanted to talk about this. The caretaker who's up there, he does, despite a reservoir being empty, there is a lot of work to be done up there, in particular storm preparation. He has that job of keeping the roads open and making sure that we don't get debris jammed in any of our gates and valves and making sure everything's going to operate as needed. We will be trucking water up to him, which is ironic for what that job entails. But he's a very frugal water user to begin with. He's doesn't have much up there for him and his family. So we will be taking that water up to him and making sure that he has adequate water. Imported water, just again, kind of a summary in this. I can move through this pretty quickly, but we were successful in securing a lot of water this year. We don't anticipate needing significant amount of state water next year. We still have water right now going into 2019 that we can keep the state water project capacity in the pipeline, at least for the city, full. This is a new graphic we've added, actual versus reserved. This gets back to that point. When capacity is available in the state project, we certainly anticipate taking advantage of it, but it's certainly something we can't plan on. What you'll notice through 2016, we were able to take advantage in several circumstances where there was available capacity. I don't believe who it was, but potentially Carpinteria not needing as much water as they had anticipated, so we were able to take advantage of that capacity.
Good question. How come the city reserve capacity fluctuates?
We typically, there's kind of a...
In the past, there was a schedule that was submitted to CCWA, and we historically would try and peak in the summer with our deliveries for state water. But going forward, you can see that there's kind of a flat line. And at that point, I think all the agencies are just planning to keep the pipe full and reserve our proportional share of the capacity. So in previous years, there was flexibility on how you schedule your deliveries because there wasn't full use of the pipeline. But going forward, we don't expect that to be the case.
Okay. Yeah, I just kind of expected it to be flat across the board. You get X percentage of the pipeline capacity. Did we give away some of our capacity in May, June, July?
That August? Was just a reflection of having higher deliveries in some months and then having to take less than in other months. So oh, okay. Previously we had more of a seasonal curve.
Okay.
Desal activity, we had some major progress last week with the completion of pressure testing of the onshore intake pipe. This has actually been something we've been struggling with over the last couple weeks. Went to pressurize that pipe and it would not hold pressure. Chased down, plug what was leaking, pressurize it again, it wouldn't hold, go back and find something else. If I was to summarize this, keeping in mind when this facility was brought online the first time, it was under similar circumstances, and unfortunately, the contractor at the time cut a lot of corners, and which invariably is excusable, except that they didn't document any of these corners that were cut, which made it very difficult when we go back in this time and find, you know, instead of putting in bolted connections, they just poured a mass of concrete around something because they didn't have any other way to bolt it together. And so if it was only one of these, that would be fine, but we've just come across all these corners that were cut during the original construction that unfortunately, even through, I think, an intensive design review, you really wouldn't have found until you pressure tested the pipe or we made some assumption to replace it entirely, potentially. I mean, but that cost would have been astronomical too. So that's really what's been plaguing us over the last couple weeks. And so being able to pressure test that pipeline onshore was a significant milestone. What remains now is to put in that transition piece that we've talked about where the communication and control electrical wires come in and out of the pipeline. There's one last segment that needs to be put in on the beach, which we hope to wrap up in the next week or so, and then begin startup and testing in January. We had hoped to be doing that in mid-December. So as far as the schedule impacts, we're still trying to figure out how we can make up for that, and I don't have an updated schedule at this time. I do have some pictures, though, just to show kind of just a general overview of the facility. This is some drone footage we have. You can see on here the three treatment units. There's a space here that's left for additional tankage if we were ever to increase capacity. Right here, the site is really set up for eight of these treatment units. And here's where the fourth one would go, right in this area here. And then the other four would go on the other side. So you could see how expansion was planned in the design. And then this is just a picture. You can see the big barge that's currently offshore. And they're working. That's right where the intake pumps and screens are. And then this is that weir box that's onshore. This is where they're putting that transition piece, just to kind of give you an idea scope. As far as desal expansion, we were getting numbers back from IDE in late January on several different options for expansion of various different capacities. And once we have those numbers, we'll bring that back for further discussion. But all of that is part of laying out our options to potentially address water supply issues in the future. We also did get confirmation of the conveyance pipeline alignment. So we now have a pretty good idea of where that's gonna go. And the cost estimate, I got a cost estimate back and I had a lot of questions for that. So I don't feel like today it's ready for prime time, but I expect in January we'll be able to start talking about what those costs are. I am, at this time, since we have the funding, I am in the project already. I'm moving forward with final design of that conveyance pipeline. And with the anticipation that we'd have something potentially to award this summer. We anticipate it taking a little over a year to construct this conveyance pipeline. Funding, yes.
The conveyance pipeline, how are you sizing that?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Davis, we are basing it on 10,000 acre feet of conveyance capacity, which put the pipeline at about 24 inch pipeline, and the velocity is pretty close to 5 feet per second, which is a good design velocity. But what flexibility we have in the future, should we need to build up to that, should we be putting potable reuse in this line, and we're maybe pushing that 10,000, you know, we don't necessarily have to push all 10,000 up. That benefits the circulation, but we could take, and we know comfortably we could use about 3,000 acre feet just in the low zone if we came down to that, what I would consider a very extreme scenario. But we've sized the pipeline, we believe, sufficiently to handle any future needs that we might have related to either desal or potable reuse. So where we've been spending the last, we've been working on this, but we really have a renewed focus on the funding. We recognize that all the costs of the drought just continue to add up, and trying to find ways to shoulder some of those costs from our ratepayers, and grant funding is, you know, the certainly something we've been pursuing. The most obvious one is the funding in Proposition 1 passed by the voters in 2014. Voters that were motivated by this drought, and we are seeking to get funding, and so far we've just keep running into roadblocks because they are moving so slowly with getting that grant funding out that our project would be deemed ineligible because the costs have been expended before the grant guidelines are out. So we are hoping, we've met with Dianne Feinstein's office, we've met with Senator Jackson, and we continue to try and push. We've asked Cal Desal to get involved, trying to get some traction and potentially a meeting with DWR and try and get them to come to look at this in a different light. You know, this is truly a drought-related project. This is real water that we're talking about bringing online here, and this is exactly what the voters of California passed Prop 1 for. We did get some information from the Bureau on their available drought funding, and it's dismal. Basically, it's about $2 million that they've made available nationwide for drought-related projects with a cap of $750,000. We will certainly apply, but it's just kind of a joke, unfortunately. And then IRWIMP funding, we're hoping. Kelly, do you remember how much the cap was on that?
The IRWIMP funding, there's projected to be about $6 million for Santa Barbara County, which would be divided among the three sub-regions within the county. So assuming it's split equally, that'd be $2 million for the South Coast. However, that implementation grant is not expected to come out until 2018. So there might be a timing issue with the whether we're eligible or not.
On Monday, there was, and maybe Mr. White, you would mind talking about what happened on Monday?
Thank you. Yeah, I was going to wait until the end of your talk here because I'm going to need to go to CCRB has a meeting starting in Goleta in a bit here, so I'm going to take off after this. But yeah, on Monday, first of all, we did meet with Ms. Jackson on Friday, and it was a good propitious time because she had gotten this meeting together with the state director of the Office of Emergency Services, and it was really quite something out at the disaster headquarters. What do they call that building out there? They
county OES, yeah.
OES, the what?
County OES.
County OES. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so he was there. Senator Jackson was there, and there were representatives of every water agency. The only water honchos that weren't there were these two sitting at our desk, and Ms. Bjork was there basically representing the city. There were 40 to 50 people there that were all the players in the regional water issue. The main point that the state and the state folks went through a statement basically showing what their forecast of the weather is, which has been no different than what we're seeing here, what the supplies are. But and they were really acknowledging that we are in a disastrous situation. That was at least heartening to see their acknowledgement. You know, you guys are really in trouble. and we see it. And what we as a state state representatives are we're here to help, and we can help most if you as a county are have one voice. And so there's Bruce Wales sitting at the table. You know what I mean? It's just, and there's sort of, you know, there's definitely some snarky vibes around the place there. But that, that message was quintuply impressed on everybody in the room. Whatever you do, you know, if you're coming at it with different voices, you're going to be much less effective. And the obvious asks that came both first to the senator and then were repeated at this meeting were the pipe in Kachuma, the pipe for the desal to get desal water conveyed, funding for the compensation for out of Prop 1 that of money we've already spent, and the chunk of addition to the desal plant going forward are kind of are pieces of the puzzle that at least I think were put into play or added into play at that meeting. So, but that, and then there's going to be the way they've worked on the drought at the state level is they meet weekly. And that's what they're recommending to us, is just get the stakeholders together and grind it out about coming up with a common message about priorities and needs and do that on a countywide basis. So I haven't heard anything. I expect that I'll get to participate in that, but I haven't heard anything yet. I expect soon, obviously, then, of course, here comes Christmas, right? So it just kind of paralyzes things to some degree. But it was an encouragement. I mean, just the fact that, you know, the big machine got mobilized this much was heartening to me. But it'll be interesting to see how we do as a county to actually come to those common messages. So, and thanks, as I say, I'm going to have to go here.
Okay. And then the state revolving fund, we are pursuing a state revolving fund loan for the conveyance pipeline. It is, I'm going to say it's optimistic. It usually takes about a year to get an SRF loan, and we roughly have about 7 months to do that. And we finally are starting to have a scope and a schedule, which is critical to starting the loan process. And so we have started down that path. We have talked to the state already. And so we're going to try and get that together so that we potentially could fund a project this summer. Meantime, we're also have already talked to the state about being increasing our loan to handle any expansion of the desal treatment plant. Water supply strategy now reflects our current ban on turf grass, and in particular recognizes that, you know, we're here in year six. We're planning out now into year eight of this drought cycle, should it continue into 2019, and we do have a recognized supply or additional conservation needed. Right now, that it's about 700 or 800 acre feet is what we've recognized there, and so that is what we're going to be talking about leading up to this spring. This is what our monthly projected use of our supplies looks like, and we don't anticipate any shortages through October. So, in kind of in summary, we're.
And if I may add that there's no projected shortages as long as we meet the 40% conservation target. Right.
This is a good point. So we continue to plan through 2019, making this an 8-year drought. Projected shortages in 2019, given anticipated decline in groundwater supply. That's really what we anticipate needing to make a decision on in spring, is to really address what we expect to be a decline of our groundwater supplies. We're not anticipating issues with state water deliveries. We're anticipating to take full advantage of our capacity. And so we will be back in early 2017 to talk about that. And what the two options that we have on the table are some type of desal expansion or increase in water use regulations.
And why aren't we looking at additional water purchases like we've done in previous years that's been successful for us before?
Yes, Commissioner Burney, Additional water purchases wouldn't do us any good at this point. It really comes down to a conveyance issue. So even though there's more snow in the Sierras, Northern California is getting more rain, that helps. But a bottleneck is still remains getting the water to Santa Barbara County is really the challenge for us. At the last council meeting, Councilmember Hart brought up, you know, what can we do to increase the capacity of the State Water Project delivery to the lake? And we've pretty much implemented all the easy stuff to do. One of the things that Mr. Hart brought up is, what can we do to increase the capacity from the Solvang pumping station to the lake? And so we did look at that. It's about, if you were to go in and replace this 15 miles of pipe that's there, it would get you about 4 CFS of additional flow to the lake. It would be nice, but I don't think it's really on par with the investment that would need to be made to make that happen.
But just kind of going back, I mean, that's always been an issue. Conveyance has always been an issue. In the last 5 years, 6 years, we've kind of found ways to work within the system. And I think, you know, Kelly had a great slide about how we've taken advantage of some of that. So I guess I'm just wondering why we don't continue with that strategy, knowing that there are limitations. It might not be perfect.
Commissioner Burney, if I may, the big difference between what we're doing right now and what it looks like in 2019 is our groundwater supply. So we expect our basins will be exhausted in the next couple of years. And without that local groundwater, we do have still the same conveyance limitations on state water, and that's what's really causing the shortage.
Mm-hmm.
What do we have right now in storage or in San Luis Reservoir, like 7,000 acre feet or something like that?
It's probably a little less than that, but
something like that. So we've got a fair amount of water sitting there, but
right,
like you're saying, we just can't get it through the pipeline fast enough.
Correct.
But we would have that water over the period of time, which would delay then a desal or other types of things if we didn't have that water in San Luis. That's the water we'll be conveying during the next couple of years, yes?
That's correct.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know, Mr. Chair, if I could.
Sure.
It's just a 30,000-foot level. Is there any place, because I really value basically seeing the kind of projections where we're at and where the water sources are coming from. Is anybody doing that or compiling basically kind of a South Coast a picture of what it looks like for the entire South Coast?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Davis, yes. That is happening on a monthly basis, and that data is getting more and more refined. But I could share that with the commission, and we could post it on... I don't know if it's a... I have to figure out how that information, but it's intended to be a planning document for all the other water agencies to kind of be able to see what's going on within the lake. And the hope is to head off any type of shortages that in one agency might occur. Yeah.
Yeah, I think at some point just to have a, maybe not, you know, ongoing, that's ongoing, but at least bring us up to date as to what the larger picture looks like.
Yeah. The hesitation you see, I mean, it's occurring. It is a draft document, so I don't know how I mean, I'm happy to share obviously our information, but I'm not sure exactly how the other agencies feel about sharing that at this point. I think that's kind of theirs. But
again, I ask the question only because it the bigger picture is important to us also in
mm-hmm. Ecuador. Yes. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Dyer, to walk us through.
Mr. Chair, Commissioners, thank you. I'm Kelly Dyer, Water Supply Manager, and it's that time of year again when we discuss our annual Water Supply Management Report. This is a report we come back every year to discuss, and it's really a backwards-looking document, looking at our previous year's water supply. And we... in normal times would really go into great depth on what our water supply situation was, but since we've been coming every month with the monthly drought updates, this is somewhat more truncated presentation. We do this report as part of our state water project agreements. It's a requirement in that agreement that We make findings that the groundwater basins are in long-term balance. So as part of, in order to reach our agreement for state water deliveries, the intent was to offset use of our groundwater. So the city has a very diverse water supply mix. It includes local groundwater, Lake Kachuma, Gibraltar, and Mission Tunnel. We have state water, as well as supplemental water purchases that are delivered through the state water system. We have local recycled water, a strong conservation program, and ocean desalination, which is expected to be online this year. So we have a very diverse water supply mix. I think this is that I think is very unique for Santa Barbara compared with other agencies throughout California. And that diversity in our supply mix is what has helped us to sustain as long as we have within with the current drought. So this is our water supply mix, and that should say for 2016. Starting at the top, the red bar is our extraordinary conservation. Comparing what was originally planned back in October of 2015, the start of the 2016 water year, we had more conservation last year, and that was a result of us increasing our conservation target from 25% to 35%. And as a result, you can see that we used less Kachuma project water, which is the blue bar. And I'd like to take this opportunity to say, I think it's quite remarkable we were able to stretch our Kachuma supplies as long as we did. The last allocation for the Kachuma project was in the 2015 water year. So that would have been October 2014 when we were given a 45% allocation. And then since then, we've had two consecutive years of zero allocations. So the fact that our community was able to conserve and stretch the Kachuma supplies as long as it has, I think is quite remarkable. The light blue bars are Gibraltar and Mission Tunnel supplies. So we did not plan to use Gibraltar water, nor were we able to because of water quality issues. But we did receive supply from Mission Tunnel, which is essentially groundwater that flows towards this side of the mountains. The orange bars are state water project and supplemental water purchases, so pretty much on par with what we had planned. Mr. Hagmark showed in a previous slide, we made more deliveries to Lake Kachuma than what we had reserved, and so those extra deliveries are sitting in storage at Kachuma right now. But in terms of water usage, it's pretty much on par with what we planned. Same with groundwater. Our groundwater use was as planned, as well as recycled water. So our groundwater basins, typically in normal to wet years, non-drought conditions, we would just base load our groundwater basins based on the safe yield, or the what's called the perennial yield. It's the amount of inflow coming in that particular year, and not really touch the stored reserves below ground. During drought conditions, we increase our pumping and actually start to use some of those storage reserves. Our groundwater is also used during emergency as an emergency supply in a catastrophic event. This is a map of our groundwater basin. So the city has two primary groundwater basins used for potable water use. The foothill basin up at the top is near the foothills, appropriately named, and the storage unit one basin is more in the downtown area. So we have about 9 groundwater wells, 7 of which I believe are currently operating. Storage unit 3 is also shown on here. This is where we have our Val Verde well, which is a non-potable well that feeds the recycled water system. So our foothill basin is shared. The city's not the only pumper. There are other pumpers in the basin. And we have been working with USGS for decades to study the basin, collecting data and doing modeling studies. And based on the most recent modeling study that we have from USGS, the drought, multi-year drought yield was 5,600 acre feet that would be available for the city, accounting for the other pumpers in the basin. The 5,600 is what would be available over a period of 5 years. The city's current production, last year's production for 2016 was 684 acre feet, and the estimated remaining yield during the drought is about 1,600 acre feet. So we expect to use that within the next few years. Water levels currently are at or below the 1992 water levels. So we are approaching some of the lows since we started recording groundwater data, but there is, you know, based on the USGS estimates, still remaining yield to be pumped over the next couple of years. Storage Unit 1, the downtown basin, the multi-year drought yield is assumed to be 7,000 to 13,000 acre feet, depending on how much seawater intrusion is deemed allowable. And the city's production in 2016 was 2,162 acre feet. So if we take the low end of the drought yield, which we did because we've been really pumping the wells that are closer to the coast, rather, you know, if we wanted to achieve some of the higher yields, we need to shift our pumping to farther up in the basin away from the ocean. So based on the lower end of the yield, we have remaining about 3,200 acre feet. So that we expect to use by 2019. We have been monitoring for seawater intrusion. We have a pretty extensive monitoring program of water levels and water quality. So from what we've seen in that data, there is some seawater intrusion occurring right near the coast, but we haven't really seen any significant increases beyond the 101. So that's really our what we've been watching closely. We really don't want it passing the 101. So we've been pumping Alameda and High School wells, which are farther inland and help to shift where the pumping is occurring in the basin. Storage Unit 3 is our non-potable basin. There are other pumpers in the basin that we recognize, and so the estimated safe yield available to the city is about 100 acre feet per year. Last year we used 22 acre feet. We really don't normally use this well. It's intended to be used to supplement or augment the recycled system when our plant is down, so for periodic maintenance or times when we need to make repairs, we do utilize our Valle Verde well to supplement the recycled system.
Mr. Chair, just going back to the other two basins, then that amount of 5 year or no, that the drought number that you gave, that's essentially for pumping that amount of water over a 5 year period of time?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Davis, yes, that was in the USGS modeling study, it was a 5 year drought period. Our interpretation is that's the amount of water available at the beginning of the drought, and then you may pump it over, you know, 3 or 4 years or 6 to 7 years, but that's essentially the storage available at the beginning of the drought.
Okay, good. Thank you.
I just had a quick question about the seawater intrusion. If we get to a point where we can take these wells out of service and replenish the basin, does that seawater intrusion start to rescind, or are we always going to deal with that in the future?
Mr. Chair, the seawater intrusion is expected to occur. It's something we recognize, and it did occur in the last drought. And interestingly, if you're looking at the chloride data, we had just reached the point when the chlorides had gone away, basically gotten back to where they were before the last drought, when we were going into this drought. So it took about 20 years before the chlorides really dissipated and the water was pushed back out. So it does take quite a long time.
All right.
Just on that point, we don't inject to protect against seawater intrusion presently, do we?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Davis, we have the capability to inject treated surface water into our groundwater basins to help with that recharge and then push the water, make it flow faster towards the ocean. But I'm trying to remember exactly what was studied in the potable reuse feasibility study. A seawater intrusion barrier was also studied in that, but it wasn't found to be the most effective option compared with other indirect potable reuse options. So,
do those fall under the same guidelines or requirements? If you're injecting, say, reuse water, does that automatically fall under the guidelines for being indirect?
Mr. Chair, it does.
It does, yes. Okay.
Mm-hmm. So the water supply management report was part of your packet, and we are accepting comments on that report. It will be posted for public review by December 23rd, and then that's about a 30-day review period before we bring it to City Council for adoption in January 24th, tentatively. So if you have any comments or questions, I'd be happy to take them now. Otherwise, you're welcome to email me if you want to read through it later and send any comments. We'll try to I would like to incorporate your comments before it becomes public. The public draft is posted on our website.
Okay. Any question, Ms. Byrne?
And you're looking for a recommendation on this, correct? Okay. Thank you. I think it's always helpful. My question is around expansion of non-potable reuse. And I know this is a backwards looking document, but the language is present in future. So it says recycled water by city customers is planned to be expanded by 300 acre feet per year in the long term. I actually would recommend that we strike that as a recommendation. I don't think we should be expanding potable reuse for two reasons. One, we have so many uncertainties with our current recycled water facility, and we're unsure we're even going to be able to meet our recycled water demands this summer, and that was an issue last year as well. And then the other issue is cost. Recycled water users are subsidized, and they're being subsidized to water their landscaping and the place we are in terms of our costs of water. I just don't think we can afford to subsidize even non-potable users going forward. And because we are now talking about potable reuse as a viable option in the future, if somebody's doing construction right now, I don't think we should encourage them to put in purple pipe, knowing that in 5 years we might not even have purple pipe available to them. So I think just kind of as a responsibility to citizens, I don't think we should. I don't recommend expansion of non-potable reuse. Otherwise, I'm absolutely good with your recommendations.
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Byrne, if I may. So currently, we're really only connecting people that are along our existing infrastructure. So we're not building expanded distribution systems. And in order to achieve that 300 acre feet per year in the long term, we would have to invest in pipeline extensions. And we've tried to address that here by acknowledging that those investments were part of our original 2011 long-term water supply plan, but that we'll have to reevaluate those investments in our next long-term water supply plan update before actually implementing them.
Is it in our city code that requires users to use recycled water if the recycled water pipeline comes near or passes their property? Okay.
That's correct. It is a requirement.
Okay. And are we pretty much like 100%? Is that taking place, or are there users that can still connect to it that haven't?
There are a few customers out there. I particularly have one, I think, right now that is kind of working its way through the process. What I want to do, I guess, frame this is the financial impacts from this drought are significant and going to be felt for a decade to come. And I think what we're going to be challenged to do is develop new sources without major grant funding, which I hope will be out there for potable reuse. But I don't want to get too carried away in the sense that, you know, maybe a pilot is in our near future, but a full-scale facility I still think is 10 to 15 years out. And that's it's just a reality, I think, of the funding that is going to be required to do such a facility and the environmental regulations that I think are going to be necessary to pull that off. I think what we heard from our and I will bring this back for a complete debrief, but what we heard from our technical advisory panel, and they're still finishing their comments, is that they thought City of Santa Barbara was an ideal location for potable reuse. They loved how our city was laid out, our infrastructure was laid out. They thought we were a good candidate. And they said, yes, there may not be any regulations, but we think the city should blaze and make their own regulations out of it, which sounds great. These the folks on the technical advisory, and some of them are from Orange County, and I said, with the backing of San Diego and Orange County, you can do that. We have a much smaller population here. Our ability to build regulations is not the same. We do not have the funding, endless funding sources that I think they can pull from their R&D research that they do, and which makes it really difficult for us to just blaze this path. And we'll be talking about it, but you know, potentially if there's grant funding out there for us to blaze that path, then certainly we can visit that. But that's, we've got quite a few hurdles to get over. I get excited about it, but then I have to remember the reality of we got a big hole to dig out of.
Right. Excuse me. That's one of the issues. The other two being we're subsidizing recycled water users, and we don't have the capacity for additional recycled water at this point. So I still feel strongly that, you know, I would move recommendation of the water supply report and Stage 3 drought update with the exception of expansion of non-potable. I don't think that I can, as a commission, I'd like to hear other people's thoughts, but I can't support that.
Commissioner Burney, I can hear your comments, and we'll, I'd like to take this, I think it's on page 9, the part you're referring to, and propose some new language, and we'll run it by you before it's posted.
Well, you made a motion. I seconded it, so you got a motion on the floor to take that out.
Okay. Are we going to have another discussion on this? Or no? Okay.
I'm assuming that motion passed.
Do we want to include that in the overall motion? You do need a motion to present this, or a recommendation to present this to council. That's what we're looking for.
You want to restate your motion?
So I move that we support the, or we recommend the annual supply, water supply report and Stage 3 drought with the exception that staff will reexamine the expansion of non-potable reuse paragraph on page 9 and 10 and bring that back to us.
Second.
Okay. First and second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None. Okay.
Mr. Chair, just one more clarification. We can bring it back to you for discussion, but we do need to get it noticed so it wouldn't be brought back to the full board for, okay. Yeah,
I agree. I think we need to get it to council for their thoughts too. So, okay, super. Thank you, Ms. Dyer. All right, moving on to item number 7, Water Resources Manager Report. Ms. Hagmar.
Okay, you have your report before you, and I apologize, can never get this report to quite be something clearly legible, but you have your production report in front of you. One that I wanted to highlight, and we're kind of looking into what may be the cause of this, but Mission Tunnel production dropped off drastically in November, almost a 40% drop in that yield, which is pretty dramatic. We didn't think it had any connections to the lake elevation because there wasn't much water in the lake either, so we're in. Can maybe see if we can find out about what happened there. Maybe.
How does that work? Do we just take as much as comes out of the tunnel?
Yeah, it's pretty self-regulated. Yeah, it just seeps in. So that was kind of unusual. The report here does recognize we did use potable water in the recycled water system for the month of November when we had those mechanical issues. The facility was back up and running on December 5th, but we did end up putting in 32 acre feet of potable water, plus we had 5 acre feet from our non-potable groundwater well, and we produced about 7 acre feet of recycled water. We certainly don't anticipate that scenario continuing to occur, but unfortunately it did happen. Next page, we're looking at just another view of conservation, and I wanted to kind of break this out. This is, I thought, was pretty spectacular. Is we're getting down, obviously, to the usage that we saw in the early 90s, but breaking it out, potable, of the 9,854 acre feet we've used over the last 12 months, about 9,000 of that is potable water, and about 800 or so is recycled water. So it's pretty significant drop in water usage overall. Next graphic shows our gallons per capita per day as a community, including all of the, you know, visitors that we have to the community. Our average gallons per capita per day is about 86. If you look strictly at our residential customers, they're currently at about 68, but we have had times where we've been around 50. That does vary seasonally. We've rain totals. Said we're just over 2.5 inches, right around 2.5 inches. Got some NOAA predictions in here for temperature and rainfall, which we've gone over. Now skipping to the Kachuma storage. Again, just reflecting now on what remains in the lake at just over 7% as compared to the last drought. And wastewater flows for November averaged 5.8 MGD, which I believe is a new low. It is a new low. So again, all of these things are interesting, and we can get into this in maybe future meetings. Just we're getting to that point in particular where our water treatment plant, our CATR, was designed to treat 6 million gallons a day minimum, and we're now forecasting and having days where it's below that. The operators are doing all kinds of workarounds to get it to operate, but potentially even looking at the need for capital projects so that we could potentially operate indefinitely at some of these lower flow rates. I know for Goleta, when I spoke to them a week or two ago, they actually had their treatment plant, Corona Del Mar, off for almost a week because demands were so low that they could keep up with their groundwater production. So we are in unusual times for sure. And then I'm very pleased to show on the SSOs that we currently stand at 6. Our goal was 8. And I think this is finally starting to see the fruits of all of our labors over the last few years to try and drive down these our spills. And we're not done. We've still got a lot of work to do out there. But this is certainly an indicator we're headed in the right direction, which is nice. Last thing I wanted
to like to commend the wastewater. I said I'd like to commend the wastewater division for keeping that number down so low. That's great.
And greatly appreciate that. Folks, men and women in our wastewater collection staff have really just done an exceptional job. That group met with them about 2 weeks ago just to commend them on November. We didn't have any spills in November, and we try to kind of celebrate some of those milestones. But just the morale in that group has really picked up. It's fantastic. They really, the ownership in this and the pride in this is big. And, you know, this is a group that was feeling pretty beat down by the spills that we were having, frustrated, you know, the work, and are now starting, you know, we've gone through all of these change. I mean, their jobs have changed dramatically, and just the sense of ownership and pride and actually being able to, you know, set some pretty lofty goals. I mean, this is way below what a normal system of our age would be seeing. I mean, so this is a pretty sizable milestone. The other point I wanted to make was water quality. I just wanted to kind of bring that back around to the group. We talked about this. We really turned a corner with the water quality, which has been huge. We've seen a big decrease in water quality complaints. And we've just wrapped up the Valtech contract, where we had that flushing, basically system flushing, where we didn't dump the water. It's basically brought through, filtered, and really got some really good data out of the system performance-wise. Found a few valves that were closed, and it's hard to tell when you have a loop system when valves are closed, but when we do that kind of flushing, we certainly becomes very obvious when a valve might be closed. But it was very helpful, and I'm eager to see as we go forward if we do see any more water quality complaints, because we were able to get a lot of that stuff out of the system. Again, we did not flush the entire system, which we would like to do, and we're continuing to talk about potentially even a capital project to buy this piece of equipment and have it on hand, maybe even potentially have our neighbors could lease it from us when they need it. But we see it as a tool of the future, particularly related to water conservation. And then again, the helpful data that it gives us about our system and its performance, it's almost like a physical. You can go through and actually see how much water you can move through certain parts of the system. So very pleased with that. And I continue, I sound like a broken record, but we are getting really close to bringing back the asset management work on water mains, and I'm really eager to talk with you about where that's going. It just didn't feel like it was ready for prime time yet, but we'll sit down and talk about that. It's going to be some painful decisions related to the future of that. And then I've also been informed that the 125 Calle Cesar Chavez property, which is currently owned by the state, but was an RDA property, it is going to be sold off here in early 2017. So we're keeping an eye on that. We see that as a potential to help us address some of the space needs that we have for a third digester and for potable reuse. And so we'll be working on bringing back something for further discussion on that. And that property certainly comes with baggage. It's known for contamination. It comes with all kinds of other issues that we'll have to take. Having gone through the estuary issue that we just talked about today during wastewater, you know, those cleanup sites can be very expensive. And so going into it, we know it's going to have a lot of issues, but it's just so difficult to find usable space for water and wastewater operations down in that area. So,
all right, great. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, under other business, Sarita and I had a conversation relative to my comment a few meetings ago about PowerPoints and not duplicating them. And we kind of talked a little bit about just duplication. I just wonder how people feel. Since we get a full packet, and you know, you've been really nice basically supplying full copies for everybody, it just seems like it's a lot of work that, since we have it, if you just bring two extra copies, if somebody forgot one or somebody from the public would want one, I'd be happy with just, you know, not having to do all that duplication before a meeting. But have the PowerPoints, like the PowerPoints today, have those just sent to us electronically, so for our files, that's where I'd like to be.
Thank you, and we did take that.
Does that make sense to you?
Yes, and we've got those presentations now after the meeting here, but hopefully by the end of this week we'll have them all uploaded, and so anybody can go on and take a look at those presentations.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Right. I think you were addressing the agenda.
Yeah,
and
I'm
these
addressing
items
all this,
too.
All the paper, because
since we get them in the mail already.
We get them in the mail. We don't need them again reproduced.
As long as they don't change.
Yeah, if there's a change, that's different.
Yeah, because now I have two copies of it.
Okay. Very good. Appreciate those.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Good
recommendation.
If it hasn't changed, we don't need the agenda either.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. We have everything.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. And then we have in here also your 2017 meeting schedule.
Yeah.
Just note that in your packet.
Okay. All right. Super.
Thank you.
All right. I guess meeting adjourned. That was at 11:10.